My next stop is the home of the rail gods of this country, the movie stars who live in Hollywood.
The cult of a celebrity vote reminds me of Disneyland. It's not rail. But people aren't rail. They play parts. And why should they be famous just because they play parts? Why should people actually think that just because John Wayne played a war hero, he was a hero?
I'm meeting a top casting director to find out if there is anything more to Hollywood than gloss.
Francis Fulford, I'm so excited to meet you. I love
you. Well, half as excited as I am to meet you.
I'm telling you, honest to God, I've never had a lord in my office before.
Well, I'm not a lord. I'm not a lord. I'm just very humble, mister.
Oh, is that what
you call
me,
Francis?
May I?
Yes, yes, you may. Or you call me Frankie, or some people even call me fucker.
Okay.
That's it. And now we are. And what are we doing? And we've got, it's all dream world here, isn't it? I look behind you. I look up on the hill, and there you got it.
Yep,
Hollywood,
I got it.
Big letter.
I got my Hollywood sign.
Tell me a little bit more about Hollywood, because my true knowledge of Hollywood really comes from reading David Niven's Moon and Balloon. And it really says it stops about 1939.
Exactly.
And you rub shoulders with what anybody would call proper celebs.
Yes, I've met Tom Hanks, and yes, I've met Tom Cruise, and I mean, and yes, I've met Bill Murray, and I've met a lot of people. For example, Damian Lewis, who shares my birthday. Do you know who Damian Lewis is?
I'm trying to think. No, I don't know who Jamie Lewis is.
He was born on February 11th, by the way. Okay, and you know, you have these great success stories. For example, you know, Brad Pitt. He is the biggest star in the world.
Even I've heard of Brad Pitt.
Yay! Brad Pitt, that's fabulous.
I wonder, many years ago, one of the quickest ways for a girl to get onto a silver screen was via the proverbial casting couch.
Wow. How do you think I got where I did in casting? Because, now, I don't necessarily agree with that these days. It really is not one of those things that you... I mean, certainly in my case, it's not. I mean, my couch is really ugly. But, I mean, you know, I have no idea what happens with these young, you know, girls who... You know, they've got these great figures, and they work it, you know, and not work
but,
it professionally.
I mean, for everyone who does make it, how many girls and boys are flooding into this town on almost a weekly basis, attracted by the chance?
Oh, hundreds. On a weekly basis,
yes.
Hundreds. And it's just, it's the luck of the draw, and it's who you meet and who you know. And, you know, there are kids who come in from, you know, Oklahoma on a bus, and then there are kids who go to Juilliard, and they pretty much, you know, if they've really got the talent, they're doing that.
Yeah, so the world's one's oyster, as long as one gets past the,
When you get past the casting director.
No, casting director.
The casting director.
Casting director.
It still seems fake and fucking silly to me. Just a lot of posturing and prancing about. Not a job a railman would admit to. I don't think fame and fortune can bring you happiness. It's just a veneer, not the real thing.
I'm on my way to the city of Las Vegas. A sort of modern Sodom and Gomorrah, by all accounts. I think it's the whole thing about Vegas is it's so shallow. It's so fucking empty. It's so pointless. But I mustn't prejudge it. Right, I'm right in it now, aren't I?
Bright light city, gonna set my soul, gonna set my soul on fire.
Everything covered in bloody neon.
A whole lot of money that's ready to burn, so get those stakes up higher. Viva Las Vegas! Viva Las Vegas!
We've got the bloody Monte Carlo, and fuck me, coming up on my right, if I'm not mistaken, we've got the Eiffel Tower, as reinterpreted for the citizens of America, so they never need to dirty their feet or bother to get a fucking passport and go to Paris. It's this old thing, you don't get poor underestimating people's taste, especially if they're American. I always forget that rule. That's why I'm still fucking poor.
Fever! Fever!
Vegas by daylight, and just as I thought, it's a shrine to fucking bad taste.
It strikes me as odd, it strikes me as bizarre, that when money is no object, the architects could build anything they like, the owners decide to build pastiches of bits of New York, bits of Paris, bits of Venice, anything but really challenging, really interesting modern architecture. The lack of imagination depresses me. Here you have the most powerful nation on earth, the new empire of America. And what do they leave to future archaeologists compared to what Rome or Greece or Egypt left to future generations? Nothing. It's pathetic. And I have to ask myself why they're doing this. And then you come to this appalling thought that maybe there's a large percentage of a population which is actually fucking moronic. Because the millions of people who come here every year don't say, how fucking awful. They say, how fucking wonderful. Hello, sir, madam. I'm from England, television. Could I ask you a couple of questions
sure.
about Vegas? What do you think of architecture at Vegas?
Best in the world.
It's awesome.
Yeah,
beautiful.
It's great.
It's beautiful buildings.
You can see New York, you can see Venice, and it's just amazing.
Everyone is very authentic.
It's outstanding.
Yeah. Amazing.
And it's like going around the world in four blocks.
Typical. No wonder more than 80% of them don't own a passport. They expect everything to be brought to them on a plate. The demand for instant gratification is ingrained in the culture here. Even one of life's most important ceremonies has been turned into a takeaway.
You have fast food, you have fast gambling, and now you have fast marriage as well. You have weddings which come and go in 15 minutes, making a mockery of what should be the most important day in someone's life.
It's so casual, anyone can walk in off the street, witnesses included, so I've offered my services at the most popular wedding chapel in Vegas.
Hi.
Hi, welcome to the Little White Wedding Chapel.
Right.
My name's Linda.
My name's Francis. I've got to go and do this wedding thing. That means I've got to get dressed up.
I can fit you, Francis. Come on with me.
Well, I've never worn white patent leather before, but when in Rome, do as the Romans do.
Right.
And so I'm swallowing my arm bile, and I, especially when I see that thing in your hand.
Ascot.
I tell you what, I've been to Ascot, Royal Ascot, and I've never seen one of those bloody things.
No, go look at yourself.
I look a complete prick, don't I, really? However, out here, I'll fit in with the scenery.
I can't believe the service does anything for the bride and bridegroom. It feels vacuous, empty here. While I think of marriage, I'm thinking of English Gothic churches, brides in white, family and friends, all the things that go to make a traditional wedding such fun. Mine was bloody good fun. I can't remember very much about it, that's the problem.
We're gathered here today at the Little White Wedding Chapel in Las Vegas, Nevada, in honor of love between Stuart and Teresa. Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
I do, Elvis. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Would you join your bride and stand next to her? Yeah, just do it.
Well, bless my soul, what's wrong with me? I'm itching like a man on the fuzz of tree. My friends say I'm acting the wallets of fun because I'm in love. I'm all shook up. Yeah, I'm all shook up. Oh.
Thank you very much.
Well, Stuart and Teresa.